Welcome to a conversation with Mr. Stuart Matthewman. I'm your host, Eric Miller. This is part of the Pods and Sods Network. You may not know Stuart by name necessarily, but Stuart is one quarter of Sade, and he's been with her since the beginning, actually since before the beginning, since she they formed the group Sade. And it was a real treat to speak with him. He has, they've sold tons of records, and we get into that, and we kind of go disc by disc through their career, and he tells some stories behind some of the key songs, and talks about the future of Sade and the long breaks between, and talks about her and some of their highlights in their career and his new project, which is called Twin Danger. And I'm a massive Sade fan, so it was a real treat to speak with him. Before we get to that, though, I wanted to thank you for downloading this episode or clicking the link or whatever combination of buttons you clicked in order to find this episode is very much appreciated. You can find more of Pods and Sods, and I hope you will look into it. More on that later. Right now, I'm going to just jump right into my conversation with Mr. Stuart Matthewman. Without any further ado, if you get it. Anyway, Stuart Matthewman, thanks. It gives me great pleasure to introduce my guest this evening, one quarter of the legendary group Sade. They've sold 24 million albums in the U.S. and about 50 million worldwide, which is just stunning. They won American Music Awards, won American Music Awards, Grammys, Brit Awards, toured the world, all kinds of stuff. Played Live Aid. Welcome, Mr. Stuart Matthewman.
Hi, how are you doing?
I'm doing well, thank you. Thanks for joining me. What I'd like to do is just some sort of intro information about your background, and then sort of go through the Sade discography to a degree, and then talk about your current project, which is called Twin Danger. So first up, just some basic biographical background. So you were born in Yorkshire and moved to London?
Yeah, I was born in a town called Hull, and I moved to London about 81, something like that.
Okay.
And kind of didn't know anyone, kind of went, I knew I had to go there if I was going to do anything.
Right.
And went for an audition for a band. The first band I auditioned with was a band called Pride. And in that band, Sade was one of the background singers. And okay. So I met her pretty early on in London. So that was pretty lucky.
Yeah, really. Yeah. So Pride, as I understand it, historically speaking, Pride was kind of a much larger band, and the other gentlemen that would eventually be in Sade's group were in Pride as well?
Yeah, well, what happened was that there was, when I joined Pride, I think it was about eight of us. There was like a lead singer, two background vocalists, I played sax and a bit of guitar. And they just kind of changed the name to another band, and so I joined on sax, and then my friend at the time, Paul Cook, who was a drummer, also from Hull, was around, and he came to a rehearsal. And then, I can't remember what happened, but anyway, Pride needed a new drummer, so Paul joined, and then Paul suggested a bass player he knew, also from Hull, that I'd known before, Paul Denman, so he joined Pride as well. And then we did, various gigs around London, around the area. We actually came to New York as well to do a gig with Pride. But we used to play, but most of the interest was always sort of around Sade. And we did a little set ourselves, just as a four-piece. just very stripped down. We did a few covers, kind of jazzy soul covers. We've written a couple of songs, myself and Charlie. And we kind of opened up for Pride. You know, went on before the main group. And people were kind of stunned by Sade and the sound that we had, because no one was really doing that, because it was so stripped down. It was so the opposite of what everyone was doing in the 80s. You know, because everything was way massively produced, with tons of reverb and all very big sounding. We had this really small sound, and Sade, of course, looks amazing. So that was where the interest was. And we stuck with Pride for a while, but eventually the rest of the guys said, you know what, you've just got to go off and do a record on your own.
I'm sure that was a pretty exciting time. And I think, if I read correctly, Smooth Operator was one of the early songs that you guys would do in that sort of stripped-down set.
Yeah, that was originally written before I was actually in the band. That was a Pride song that Sade had written with the guitar player, Ray St. John.
Right.
And I think originally it was like flute. It was kind of a little bit more Latin. And, you know, I obviously, you know, came up with the sax line. And we just changed the arrangement, you know.
What did you, going back to your earlier years growing up, you know, when did you start playing? What kind of music did you listen to in your formative years?
Oh, my goodness. I mean, when I started playing the recorder at school, then the clarinet, I was kind of classic, did classical stuff and did little competitions around the area playing the clarinet. And then I, you know, the clarinet wasn't very cool. And I wanted to, then I saw... And I think people get inspired by jazz players or by soul players, like in saxophone. But I actually got inspired by seeing Roxy music and then David Bowie, like, you know, because they had, you know, David Bowie played sax. Roxy music had a sax player. I thought, oh, wow, you can play the sax and be in a band, you know, in a cool band. So I started learning the sax, and then I got into more kind of R&B and jazz and all that kind of thing. I didn't ever sit down and learn jazz, for sure. I just kind of... enjoyed listening to it. So it's been an influence, jazz, but I wouldn't say that I just didn't have the I couldn't do the 8 hours a day practicing scales then to be a true jazz person, you know. So I play more by my tone and by feel rather than by, you know, a ton of notes.
That makes sense.
Yeah, so that was an influence. I mean, but songwriting also, I mean, all the music I loved when I was a kid, you know, it spanned from like punk to Al Green to Curtis Mayfield to it was always kind of like, to reggae, you know, it was always kind of like the more stripped down, simple arrangements and sounds. It didn't sound like people were showing off.
Right.
It just sounded like everyone was kind of fit in with each other. You know, I love bands like the Average White Band, where everyone just kind of slotted in together. No one was trying to show off. And, you know, it wasn't like this. You know, I wasn't really into fusion or, you know, jazz rock and all that kind of thing, you know.
That's right.
more simple kind of stuff, you know, which was definitely influence when it came to, you know, when we were writing with Sade. I think we're all the same, you know. All Sade was like that as well. She was never into, like, real sort of show-off kind of style stuff, you know.
Yeah, some of the music, especially later on, gets to be kind of minimalist and just brilliant in that, so... Yeah, you can certainly hear the influence, and you've described it well.
Yeah.
So you mentioned you kind of broke off from Pride, and you were signed in 84. Was there a period there where that you were kind of gigging before? Like
we were doing little gigs here and there. We played, you know, we played Ronnie Scott's a couple of times. That was very cool. You know, we'd have it on like a Sunday night, like an off night, And yeah, just kind of little gigs. But Sade was very much in the London scene. Like, that was a few of the real kind of trendy clubs. And at those clubs, it's not so much like it is nowadays, but back then, the clubs that we went to, everyone did something in the club. So you'd have like the graphic designer and the clothes designer and the singer and the journalist and the drug dealer and the photographer. Like it was like a little... like a kind of club, do you know what I mean? So,
right.
So if someone is in a band, everyone would help each other out. You know, you'd automatically use that guy to do the graphics and this guy would take the photos. It was very kind of, not cliquey. Yeah, I kind of guess cliquey kind of thing. So Charlie was very much part of that. And me and the other guys from Hull managed to worm our way into that because it was very kind of a trendy London scene. But us three northern boys managed to worm our way in there. And so... Yeah, so Charlie was also was in a bit of a spotlight. She was doing like magazine shoots and stuff, and we actually did a couple of TV shows before we even signed. So, people were definitely, looking at Sade and talking about her before we got signed.
The first album, the reason I'm kind of curious about this period is because, when the first album hits in July of 84, which is Diamond Life, it blew up
Right.
in a hurry. So,
Yeah, in England, yeah, and Europe, yeah.
it sounds like there was a bit of kind of a swell or buzz around it even before.
Yeah, there's definitely a buzz. It was like the, we did a couple of demos. Well, we went in the studio with a producer called Robin Miller, who'd heard some of our really rough demos, and he wanted to record with us. And we were like, well, yeah, that'd be great. So we went in the studio and we did, three songs. We recorded Smooth Operator, a song that I'd just written with Sade called Your Love Is King, and then an instrumental track. And we recorded those kind of as a working demo. We weren't signed or anything. We did those, and then we used those to shop the deal. We ended up signing to I think it was CBS in England, Epic in America. Anyway, but we. So we signed to them, and that they got what we'd already recorded. We didn't sign and then go in the studio. So we had those three songs. We released it as a single first. I think we released Your Love Is King first, and that kind of went straight in the charts, like number six. And Smooth Operator was on the B side of that. And then later on, we ended up re-releasing it as like the A side as well. So. Quite interesting.
Yeah, did it feel like, so you recorded in London, signed in
Yeah.
84, released in July. So that means you must have recorded it, in a pretty quick turnaround.
Yeah, everything happened a lot very quite quickly at that time. We had no expectations whatsoever. We didn't, I didn't even own a radio. We weren't thinking about radio. We just went out to clubs, and we knew that we weren't club music. We were just doing our thing. We were just happy to be in a recording studio, recording and getting fed, and they had a little bar there and stuff. So we were just really happy. I mean, I was living in a kind of a squat. Shadows living above a disused fire station. I mean, it wasn't, desperate, too desperate. But I mean, we weren't thinking about. We were just happy to record, and we didn't think we were ever going to be doing big gigs or selling a lot of records at all. So it was a nice surprise when, the first song, Your Love Is King, started going up the charts.
Yeah, that certainly had to have been. In the US, I think the one that really broke was Smooth Operator.
Yeah, they went with that. Yeah, they actually released Hang On To Your Love first in America, because they didn't think, they were scared a bit of the others, like Your Love Is King and Smooth Operator, and they released Hang On To Your Love to R&B radio first, and then Smooth Operator. But America took, I don't know the exact date. So it took like a year before they released the album. They kind of sat on it for a while because they were kind of, I don't, you can only speculate and you have memories of it's so long ago. But I think they were kind of scared of putting it out. They had to do some groundwork first, even though it had done so well everywhere else. It was so different to what was happening in America, like kind of sound-wise with, and because Sade and myself, the way we wrote songs, and even Smooth Operator that she'd written with Grace and John, we're not, classic kind of songwriters. We hadn't done it before. Sade just started writing when we got together, writing songs. So we didn't really understand the whole, you start the song with a short intro, then there's a verse and a pre-chorus and a chorus and another verse. We didn't kind of know that stuff. So if you actually listen to Smooth Operator, the chorus doesn't kind of come in for about 2 minutes on the original. There's like this percussion intro, then there's sax, then she kind of talks a bit, then there's this verse, and same with Your Love Is King. There's no actual kind of chorus or verse. It's kind of quite, beautifully naive the way that we did it, because we didn't really know what we were doing, So it wasn't like usual radio stuff, for America. So I didn't think they didn't think they could get Smooth Operator on the radio at all. We tried doing all sorts of different edits.
Diamond Life.
kind of as it was, like the regular 7-inch version, and it was played to death.
Right. So, and that's right as MTV is really picking up steam, so it was, you know, perfect timing. And like you said, she's glamorous. And
I mean, we always had a bit of a hard time with radio and TV, just because we weren't, you know, that big 80s kind of big shoulder pads, big hair, lots of reverb. We weren't kind of that thing. So
you didn't pick that up from David Bowie, in other words.
So I still love him. David Bowie, massive influence.
So in terms of recording the first album, I also read that much of it was done live, and you had some, you know, some fun mixing it and things like that. Can you talk about the making of that? You know, like you said,
I mean, it was done live, but we didn't really all play live in the studio. No, I mean, very often you put the drums and bass down. You put like a rough, you'd have a rough template of the song, and then you'd put it down. I mean, honestly, a few of the songs were done, like the song Sally was done with a drum machine, very early days, like Lynn drum. Hang On to Your Love and some of the other ones are like drum triggers, you know, like there's like old delay units that you could do a short sample on. So I think some of the snares and things were triggered, you know.
Right.
So we weren't, you know, definitely wasn't, we've always kind of embraced technology. We weren't trying to do like a all recording live at the same time. We've only done that a couple of times in the studio, to be honest. So like all the guitars and the sax and everything was kind of done separately.
Right. Okay.
But mixing was fun because, you know, it was before automation when we were doing Down in Life. So the song like Cherry Pie, if I was just listening to that the other day, I saw something about the mixing of it. And there's quite a lot of stuff going on, like with different echoes and delays and pannings and level changes. So I think there's about five or six of us leaning over the board at the same time, you know, changing things and adding reverbs and panning things and volumes. And we went, you know, we put that down to tape and maybe do a few passes of the mix and then cut it together, you know, edit it together.
Right. It sort of underscores in a nice poetic way the, you know, the young band sort of discovering their way through, you know what I mean? Like the unification that you guys must have been feeling. So
I remember when we first got... I don't know what keyboard it was, a DX7, then we found out about MIDI, and I was like, oh, my goodness, you know.
Fine, you know. Right.
That's so outdated now. We didn't really quite know what we were doing, but our producer at the time, Robin Miller, did. You know, he was very experienced, and the engineer that we had, Mike Peeler, was very good. And we stuck, you know, Mike Peeler's been with us on everything we've ever done, so... You know, he wouldn't mind me saying it. He's not like the top engineer in the world by any means, but he knows us so well at this point. He knows our sound. He knows how to be with us in the studio, and he's the only one with the patience and the right temperament to stick with us. We can be a bit of a challenge in the studio sometimes.
Yeah. Also, this year, this had to have been a milestone. In July of '84, you played the Montreux Jazz Festival. You know, sharing the stage with Miles Davis and B.B. King, I think Stanley Jordan, a lot of people on that bill. How, you know?
I have no idea who was on the bill. You know what? We missed our flight getting there. We were meant to be on really early on. We did Montreux a couple of times, but the first time, we were meant to be on like first or something, early in the evening, but we missed the flight. We had to go, so we were really late. We went there straight without our luggage. So Shadi hadn't got anything to change into. All she had on was a raincoat kind of thing that she had on. So she basically kind of took everything off underneath it, apart from her underwear, and put a pair of heels on, and that was what she wore. We ended up going on really late, like after some of the main bands that kind of threw us on at the end. So we ended up sort of more headlining than we should have been.
Cool. Yeah. It's kind of a nice...
All those times were a bit of a blur. It wasn't like it was a blur of hedonistic, like, drugs or alcohol necessarily. It's just a blur of... There's always something nutty going on or some drama. So, you know,
right.
You kind of get caught up in that. Yeah.
So the debut, Diamond Life, went on to sell, I think, over 6 million worldwide, which is just incredible.
I mean, it was one of those records that you could just... I mean, London or, you know, I was in London at the time. I mean, it was just came out of everywhere. I mean, it got a bit ridiculous, you know. You just hear it on the radio, but then you'd walk into all the kind of department stores and the high street fashion stores were playing it. And then you go in a restaurant and be playing it. You'd hear it coming out of people's cars. It was just insane. But then the English, as we know, are very opposite of Americans. That if something becomes very, very popular, this was back then, they start kind of knocking it because everyone else likes it.
Right.
It's all the kind of, you know, all the cool, trendy people love it and say it's the most amazing thing ever. And then everyone else starts liking it. And then the kind of cool, trendy people can't like it anymore because everyone else likes it.
Right.
So we always had a bit of a battle with that, with our records in England. You know, we went from being like very super hip and very popular to being popular, but being kind of slagged off, you know, the same thing that they were loving us, you know, about, you know. I mean, right. People would say stuff about us that was over the top, you know. It's like, oh my gosh, she's a new Billie Holiday. And then when everyone else was like totally into it, you go, oh, she's nothing like Billie Holiday. You know, it's like we'd never said anything.
Right.
It was quite funny.
That's
anyway,
funny.
You know, but Charlie's amazing. She takes all that stuff with a grain of salt.
Right.
You know, she could really care less.
I think you'd have to, really, you know. I mean, you're...
Yeah.
You know,
Charlie's one of the absolutely most unique people I've ever met in my life, like as an artist or a musician or a songwriter, is that she really could care less about the fame or the... She's not remotely doing it for that. You know, sure, it's great that she's been successful and she can be comfortable now and all that. She's enjoyed playing to enormous crowds and everything, but that wasn't a motivation at all. You know, I wouldn't say she's shy, but she just wasn't interested in the whole celebrity thing at all, you know.
Right. Yeah, even, you know, there's very little kind of interviewing that she's done for the records. Like, in hindsight, you know, she was never... Yeah, you get that sense on this side of the stage that you know, that was never her motivation, which I think probably even adds to the appeal, you know.
It absolutely does. And that's why she's lasted so long. And that's why people are so excited when a new record comes out or when they go see her. You know, when she plays live now, it's to an audience, it's like the equivalent of seeing Frank Sinatra or Billie Holiday or you know, whoever it is. It's like she's a complete icon. She's, you know, anyway, you don't see her doing tons of adverts and commercials and selling this and that, you know, and at every opening, you know, she's never done that.
Right. Yeah, no need. You know, that's not the business you're in, you know. I can certainly respect that.
I mean, it's harder nowadays, you know, and it's because everything is about social media and it's about talking about yourself and it's about being... But the way that Charlie manages to get around that is that she doesn't, you know, she has no Facebook or Instagram or Twitter or anything like that. But what happens is that there's various artists, whether it's Beyonce or Kanye or Jay-Z or Snoop Dogg, whoever it is, you know, people who love Charlie. So when a Charlie record comes out, they say, oh my God, Charlie's got a new record out, you know, so, and all those fans then find out about it, you know.
Right, right.
And sort of Charlie doing other kind of people do it for.
It's nice. It's a good spot to be in, no doubt. So less than a year later, again, talking about, you know, a huge, huge gig, July of 85, before the next record, you play Live Aid, which was 30 years ago.
Yeah.
30 years ago yesterday, as of record is. Any memories about that?
Yeah, I know. It's crazy, right? Yeah, I think I said before, I was only 5 years old when I did that. But,
right.
But that was very odd because, I mean, you know, there's all these bands playing, like, you know, there was like Queen and U2 and, you know, and we're playing in a stadium in front of 75,000 people going live to a billion people doing Your Love Is King, Is It a Crime? And which is, you know, we were used to playing that small clubs, you know,
right.
And all of a sudden we were in front of this insanely large audience, but they were really into it. I mean, we were so nervous, oh my goodness. And there's no sound show. They just kind of threw you out there. But looking back, it's really good. You know, we got away with it. Is it a crime? Is it a crime that I still want you? And I want you to want me.
Oh, now you more than held your own on that stage, and that's something to be said when Freddie Mercury's on that same stage,
Oh my goodness, Oh, David Bowie and everyone,
Yeah. Think about a song like Is It a Crime when, her voice carried in that stadium. You know what I mean? Like I never had the
Oh, yeah,
pleasure
of course, yeah.
to hear it in a club, but that song in that setting, I think still hit big time.
Oh, yeah, that was always a very powerful song for us. It's one that's very, very dynamic. We actually recorded that live in a studio. I think we ended up sort of redoing a couple of overdubs, but that was actually done as a band studio live.
And that brings us to the next record, which was November of '85, and that's Promise. Again, recorded in London. Same producer, producing team, production team. This one hit number one in the US and number one in the UK.
That was a different thing because we'd you could, when you do the second album, you're starting from scratch. We didn't have like any other songs, but we had been doing Is It a Crime? Like we kind of did a rough kind of wrote it at a rehearsal, I think, and then we started doing it at sound checks. We ended up playing it live when we were doing the Diamond Life tour. So that was like one song we had. We knew that was a really strong song, so we then started building other songs around it.
Right. Sweetest Taboo and Never As Good As the First Time were some of the singles from this.
Sweet Taboo. That was a song written that she wrote with our percussion player Martin Ditchin, who had this odd drum beat that percussion thing that he'd done. I think he did it on a drum machine originally, and then and this sort of quirky guitar thing, and then we ended up arranging it as a band. But she wrote that with our percussion player. That was really cool.
Right. And Is It a Crime was not, it was not a single per se, right? Like it.
It was actually put out as a single. It was put out as a single because we had a video for
Okay.
it. I mean, it's definitely a single. It was like a 12-inch album, so it was a single. It was one that we edited down for radio.
Any sort of nerves or pressure, because now it's, they say the sophomore slump, you're in the record number two, and number one was massive. So did you feel anything at the time, or were you guys aware of that?
I guess. I mean, everything's happening so fast, and you're kind of young, and you're busy doing so much stuff. I don't know, so much stuff going on that you kind of don't. It wasn't at that point. It wasn't a big gap in between the record. We kind of went straight into it, so we didn't kind of have time to be nervous. But
Right.
we just kind of, it was just, we just did it. We knew we were just writing songs. And Charlie had something to write about. Charlie needs to have something to write about to do an album. She needs to have stories and things to have happened.
Right.
So there was plenty to write about.
Now, when it comes to writing between you and her, I'm sure it varies song by song, but do you tend to write the music and she tends to write the lyrics, or how would?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, she definitely writes the lyrics. I mean, we'll help here and there, like as a band or individually, just saying, I like that, I don't like that. Why don't we swap that? Or, I mean, or we'll go. She has these massive books of one-line lyrics that she's always writing down and kind of go through and pick lines out. But she's definitely the word person, and she's amazing at stripping everything down to saying something very simple. Kind
Right.
of very minimalistic. It's not like a minimalistic poet, like those, or someone telling a short story. She's amazing at that. Other people put in way too many words, but she's all about stripping it out. So I do the music with her. We'll help her. She often does her own melodies, but sometimes it'll literally be me strumming chords or having like a backing track, and she'll be singing along with that. Sometimes she'll, it's just always different.
Right.
Sometimes I'll have a complete backing track. Sometimes I'll just be strumming some chords. Sometimes she has some lyrics. We start doing some chords around the lyrics. It's just, sometimes I hate to say the word, we all hate the word, but we kind of jam in the studio a bit, kind of messing around and get some ideas out of that. Hopefully, the end result doesn't sound like jamming, but you just get something out of it, like a bass line or guitar riff or some weird accident that happens,
Right. Any songs in particular that you can think of that came out of just sort of a jam?
I guess Paradise. We knew we wanted it. She wanted it to be like a train rolling along or something, like a motion thing. So we had this drum beat, and we're just going through this Paul was messing around on the bass for ages, and so showed, oh, that's a bass line. You know, it kind of just came about from us. Very adamant that she didn't want any drum fills or cymbal crashes, so she actually ended up sort of running into the studio and pulling the tom-toms and cymbal stands away from the drum kit, so I couldn't do any fills.
Right. Well, it adds a lot, and that, you know, I mean, that's jumping ahead slightly, but that video of the horse riding is just, you know, just spectacular, and that, you know.
Oh, that one, that's never as good as the first time, I think. That one.
Right.
Yeah, the horse one, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's always a recurring horse theme.
Right.
The horse in Sweet of Stryper video as well.
And then, right.
When we did Soldier of Love, she had a horse in that as well.
Right. Oh, I'm mistaken. I thought Paradise was the horse.
Well.
Right. My fault.
Nah. She had a horse in Paradise. Paradise was the one that was in Mexico, and she's got like the cowboy hat on. And it's like,
right.
Boxing.
Right.
Boxing and the girl. Yeah.
Yeah, you have to remember I was a teenage boy when these videos were coming out, so...
Yeah, I was only about 10 years old. Well, yeah.
They struck a nerve for me, I'll say. So moving on, the next album, in April of 88, so there's a bit more of a break here. We took a breather. I'm sure you toured extensively. Stronger Than Pride, which has Paradise on it, like we said.
That one we started off, I don't know if we started it, but we went to Nassau, Bahamas, and recorded there for a bit, and yeah, we got quite a few songs out as well, and then did more in London, and then France, I think, yeah. At that point, we were doing this thing where we'd have to be out of the country, we were doing some kind of, like, everyone was doing it at the time, where you'd, I think for tax reasons, if you recorded outside the country, you didn't have to pay tax. So I don't know, some weird stuff.
Right.
But we were really worried about the tax. We were just told, oh, go to France to record. We're like, hell yeah.
Right. And that studio...
better than Hull.
Right, there you go. And that's... I can't say that. I've never been there. But the studio in the Bahamas is kind of a legendary one, or do you know?
It's the one where they, you know, they did all the great jam stuff. It's all like Compass Point, it was called.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of island record stuff is done there.
What specifically? Why did you go? Why there? Like, what about that appealed to you? Do you remember any of that?
I don't know. I guess it was a mix of getting out of the country. It was a good studio. It was sort of being a little bit hedonistic, I guess. You know.
Right.
Let's go there and record. Yeah.
Did that in,
it was great. It was good fun.
Did that in any way change the complexion of the record? Being out of London?
I'm not sure. I mean, I don't know if it sounded any more sunny particularly. I mean, we'd mainly be in a darkened studio, which could be anywhere. You know? But maybe slightly. I don't know. I'll have to kind of re-listen to it again. I don't think so, though. You know, we had not particularly, I don't think it changed. We were just changing, you know, the sound was gradually changing. I was playing more guitar, playing less sax. And it was just, we were just changing the sound, you know, simplifying everything.
Right.
Making it maybe a bit more soulful rather than jazzy.
Right. Yeah, some of the songs from this, the singles, Love is Stronger Than Pride, Paradise, like we mentioned, Nothing Can Come Between Us, which was the first video with Sophie Muller.
The first video she did was Stronger Than Pride. It was the one that we did on the beach. I won't Malibu, and the other part was done near where Charlie grew up in Clacton,
right.
England, Essex.
Right. Yeah, so. Hey, was there any? So you're really in a successful band at this point, and this is maybe slightly an odd question, but you know, Sade often, you know, people think of Sade as just Sade Adu, right?
Yeah.
But
yeah.
You know, but the fans know that Sade is the four of you, right?
Yeah.
Was there ever any? Did you have ever any like mixed feelings about that, or?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, early on, very early on, I guess when Diamond Life was out, because we knew that we were very different from everything else, but we were going around and we were on the same kind of circuit and the same kind of thing as all those bands like, you know, Spandau Ballet and Duran Duran and you know, all those sort of big Depeche Mode, all those kind of bands. And we, you know, and they were all in the magazines, and everyone knew what all the individual bands, you know, names were and stuff. And, but we were in this band where, you know, with this beautiful girl singer, and she was the only one that anyone was really interested in taking photographs of or, you know, talking to. She was like the front person. So at one, you know, sort of early on, I guess it was, I was sort of a bit jealous. I want to be, you know, more of a... in the limelight, but pretty soon we realized that, hang on, this is actually really good, because we could go out to clubs,
right?
And we could, you know, we could pull some clout being like a top band. You know, you could get into clubs, you could, you know, if you know, you could get looked after. But we weren't overly bothered, you know, by people, by press, so we could get away with a lot more. You know, the hedonism or ridiculous stuff you get up to in the mid-80s, we could get away with it, where the other bands, you know, journalists constantly talking about them and insane girls going nuts after them. We didn't have that as much. We could get away with a lot more.
Right.
Which was, but we still had the respect, and we were still selling the records. So it was, it ended up being, you know, really good.
Right.
For me, anyway.
Yeah, Dave Grohl actually said once when he was in Nirvana, you know, because Kurt Cobain was such a massive star, he said he could just, you know, he could walk through the venue at any gig, you know, just like walk through the front door to their own concert without being, you know, harassed. So, you know.
That's funny.
And then, you know.
We played, I must have been 2-3 years ago, we played in Australia, and Foo Fighters were there, and Dave Grohl, Foo Fighters came to see us, they all sitting at the side. Like in the arena, we could all see them watching, and then he came backstage. He was like a big Sade fan.
All right. Did he know who you guys were, or he just sort of beelined to her?
Yeah. We were chatting away and stuff. Yeah. Nice.
So moving on, in October of '92, and again the breaks are getting a little bit longer. This is Love Deluxe.
Yeah. That's still my favorite album. That's the one I like all the albums for different reasons, but this one I definitely like the most. It wasn't because of how it was recorded, it was just the sound. I just love the sound. It was just very minimal, and it was more kind of R&B sounding.
Right.
We were a lot more into kind of programming. We got more into, like, you know, some of the basses, like Moog bass, it was programmed. We got like an Atari computer we were doing, you know, programming on, drum machines and samples and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
But just keeping it really simple. You know, it was more about taking things off, you know, taking things off rather than adding them on, you know. And what was amazing about Love Deluxe is there's quite a lot of kind of mistakes. I mean, a kind of, you know, people probably know about them now, but stuff like Cherish the Day, like the guitar riff at the beginning, it's very kind of very super simple guitar riff at the beginning, but it's very, you know, when you hear that, you know it's that Sade song, you know, there's like, it's only like two notes, three notes or something. But the way it happened was that we had the backing track, and I wanted to do some guitar parts, try some guitar things on the track. And so I kind of plugged the guitar in, and Mike started playing the track, and I said, are you getting enough level? You know, are you getting enough level to tape? And as I was talking, I was just kind of doing these three notes, ding, 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 ding. And it wasn't, I wasn't really thinking about it. I wasn't like trying to do a riff or anything. I was just giving him a level on the guitar.
Wow.
And so I kind of did that for a few bars, and I stopped, and I said, okay, I'm ready to try some ideas. And Charlie was sitting in the back, and she went, no, that was it, what you just did. And I was like, what do you mean? I haven't done anything yet. She says, no, that was brilliant, what you just did. And I said, what did I do? I have no idea what I did. And they played it back, and then we ended up like sampling the first part of it and just repeating it. And that was, became like the main riff. You know, now, you know, you're playing these big arenas, and as soon as you start playing that guitar riff, everyone goes nuts. You know, it's just a mistake.
Another monstrous hit on that album, Grammy winning, No Ordinary Love. Any memories about that one?
Oh yeah, that was amazing. So I mean, I actually, that was one of the songs that I had like a backing track for. So I kind of had the bass line, the drum pattern, and the keyboard line, you know, the keyboard chords and all that. And then Charlie just wrote over the top of it. And then we were in the studio just trying, you know, trying different sounds and doing stuff. I was going to do some guitars. I wasn't kind of sure what kind of guitar to do on it. And I had, I don't know, it was like a fuzz box or something, I don't know, some kind of distortion pedal. And I kind of had it on too loud. And I started doing like kind of joking, doing this kind of chuggy guitar pattern. And Charlie's like, oh, well, sounds great. You know, I love that. So that ended up being on the song, you know, like guitar, you know, guitar stuff, which you wouldn't normally expect on a, you know, on an R&B kind of song. That was interesting. Yeah. And that became more of a feature when we played live. It was always whacked the guitar up a lot louder. But the thing about Charlie in the studio, that whatever you think, you know, you can't, we all kind of know what we like and what we don't like, but you can never be too safe in the studio. You know, so you can always, you know, you should always try stuff that's a little bit, you know, out of the ordinary or left field. It could well work. You know, Charlie may just pick up on it. That's, you know, how So Good Love came about later on. You know, start
right.
Doing different stuff.
How about Kiss of Life? Anything, any memories specifically about that one?
That was a song, I think I just had the chords, and then we kind of, that was one that we just kind of arranged in the studio.
Right.
That was just, you know, I got to play, sax on that more, you know, baritone sax. Yeah, we started having not as much sax, so the sax was used more of as a ambient kind of background sound rather than the forefront, you know, which was cool. You know, I was writing the songs and doing the sounds and the guitar, so I was okay with that.
Kind of. Right. Now, going back to when you started playing, you started on the sax, or like at what point did you pick up the guitar?
About the same time. I mean, well, probably about the same time. But my brother had a guitar that I wasn't allowed to touch, and but whenever he used to go out, I'd kind of pick it up and try and play along with Black Sabbath or whatever records I had at the time. And then I got into the Sex Pistols came out, and I bought that album and Mind the Bollocks, and just kind of religiously sat down and learned to play every part on it. You know?
Right.
For hours, I just played Sex Pistols. You know, I loved that. So that's kind of how I learned the guitar, doing that. And then listening to, Marvin Gaye and Al Green, just all these, while I watched, the massive influence, because he was just so cool and simple and did all these really cool little riffs, little hooky lines and wah-wah parts. Now, that's why I wanted to use influence on using wah on with Sade, on Diamond Life. I've always used the wah-wah pedal.
Right. You feel more comfortable on one or the other, or?
Not really. It's a different. It's a completely different thing. I love playing a sax live. It's like a sax is. I don't know. For me, it's the most thing to like the voice.
Right.
You can really express yourself. You can't get away with anything. You have to have a good tone. You can't get away with it. You have to be able to do it, or you can't. Like with guitar, you can get away with a lot more stuff with volume and pedals. Sound and stuff. The sax is more like a voice.
Yeah. Right, so, and you certainly have your own voice. You hear one of your sax parts, and we know it's you.
People I listen to were always like Stan Getz and Ben Webster people, or John Coltrane when he played ballads. So I was never into John Coltrane when he played the real fast one. Free jazz thing, but I just love the ballads, and it was all about the tone. It wasn't about showing off, it was just having a good sound. Like Stan Getz, he always immediately knew that sound.
Right. Yeah. And that's something that, all these records, you certainly have adhered to that sort of philosophy. So after Love Deluxe, after the tour wraps up, you go on a bit of a hiatus. And during that time, you do the first Sweetback album, which is yourself, right. Yourself, Paul, and Andrew. So how did that come to be?
Yeah, well, I mean, we were, we were saying, I can't remember who suggested, maybe someone on the label said, why don't you do an instrumental album? So we'd always done an instrumental track on Sade albums, and originally it was just going to be instrumental, and then I'd been working with Maxwell. I just met Maxwell and started working with him. And so he ended up singing a song. We just ended up having these guest vocalists. We ended up using Mel LaRue from Groove Theory.
Right.
And it was just kind of who was around at the time in New York that we came out in our kind of circle,
Right.
But, that was definitely not meant to be like a big, we knew it was just like kind of a cool side project thing.
And it's great. I certainly enjoy that, and you did one later in 2004. As far as the timing goes, was there, the impression is, I don't know how true this is, but I don't know where Sade was at that point, but I think a lot of the press around this picked up on the fact that it's a Sade record without Sade. So was there any was there like any frustration or like any divide or?
Yeah, not really. No, I mean, Sade wasn't ready to do a new record anyway. We were all kind of doing different stuff,
Right.
Andrew was doing stuff. I was doing started doing film scores. I was working with Maxwell and doing all different stuff. And I wasn't ready to take a break.
Right.
Sade was fine.
Gotcha. And you did the first two Maxwell albums. You did pretty much everything, producer, co-writer, guitar, sax, mixed program. I think you even delivered them to the stores, didn't you?
Probably. I definitely went to the master as well. But, I met Maxwell, and originally I'd been sent demos of him, and I was asked if I wanted to write or produce them. The demos were so kind of finished and amazing sounding that I was like, why do you need me? That kind of thing. And I was kind of busy doing other stuff at the time. I kind of wasn't, I was meant to meet him and I didn't. And then finally our percussion player, Carl, who still plays percussion with us, with Sade, said, oh man, I've been working with this kid in the studio. He's really cool, you should meet him. And so he literally brought him over for me to meet to my place, my apartment in New York, and I kind of met Maxwell. We hung out. I said, "Oh yeah, we should write together." And then we ended up writing three songs, and I worked on the backings with him and produced it and played on them and stuff. And then he had me playing on other tracks on the album, so I played guitar on the other songs of his, and sax on other songs, and I kind of spread myself over the record. Which, that was Urban Hang Suite. And then second album, I did three songs on that, same kind of thing, and then played on other tracks. And then on the third album, did the same thing. Did like, I think it was three songs on the third album as well. Now,
right.
It's called.
Right.
I only worked on the other one, the fourth one, but we were in the studio with Shadow. It's my time, could go up to.
Right.
It's a shame.
Yeah, so you reconvene in 2000 following the Maxwell albums, with the other for Lovers Rock. How did that reconnection come about?
Oh God, it's really odd with us because we have a really odd thing about time. Even if we're not seeing each other or hung out or whatever, when we hang out, we're just such old friends. There's been no really bad stuff between us, and we all know each other so well that we just kind of fall back into it pretty easily.
Right.
So we, I think I had a few kind of tracks that I'd worked on that maybe I'd sent to Sade on cassette or something, or CD at the time. So we had something to start off with. But a lot of it, by this time we were working on computers. So, I'd me and Andrew or whoever would turn up at the studio with tracks kind of already, started. So we had stuff to work on,
Did you have?
We kind of fell into that pretty easily, I think.
So I guess kind of one of the questions would be, so it's 8 years between the two. So did you have like label pressure? Like it makes sense artistically to take a break, but
You know what? The label know at this point that there's absolutely no point forcing Charlotte to do anything. She'll never do anything. If she doesn't want to do it.
Right.
And Charlotte's not going to go in the studio unless. I mean, I really can't talk for her exactly, and she's never told me exactly what to say or anything, because it's just not that way. But I just know that Sade knows. Sade's just not, because she's not the big celebrity,
right?
Thing. She can't, necessarily doesn't want to talk about herself and involve her friends in her part, stuff, So she knows that when she goes in the studio, once you've done like two or three songs, and once the manager kind of comes by, and the record company starts sniffing around, that she knows she's making a record.
Right.
And then she knows that she knows that you've got to start thinking about doing photos, and you've got to start thinking about doing videos, and then you're going to do TV shows, and you've got to do interviews and press and all that, and then eventually a tour. So she's got to be in the right frame of mind to know, and that's quite a long process. That's like a 2 or 3 year process of being Sade, if you know what I mean.
Right.
So instead of just Sade, who's a total homegirl in at home with friends and family, So she has to have everything cleared out in her life to do that, and she also has to have stuff to write about, So it was just the right time to do it then.
Right.
She had time to do it. She felt comfortable going to the studio, and she felt okay that we do photographs and stuff,
Yeah.
That's always the challenge, when the record company's involved, and then you go, "Oh, right, yeah, we're actually doing a record." And then it becomes deadlines, and then there's first singles, and we've got to get this remix, and we've got to deliver everything on time, and then it becomes a bit of a nightmare.
Right. And what a fortunate and blessing, to be in a position like that, to actually, be able to sort of make that a reality at your own pace, based on your own needs, versus,
Yeah, I mean, I personally, I'd probably definitely have the gaps a little shorter. I'm sure we all would, but Charlie's also, I'm kind of saying this tongue-in-cheek, but she's Nigerian. She's Nigerian-born, and she just has a different time zone than everyone else, a different time scale. So she'll, I know we finished a tour 3 years ago. She probably thinks we finished it like a year ago. She just has a different, if she goes in her garden to work in her garden, and she'll, I'm around visiting, so it's going to be like 10 minutes. She'll be gone for like 2 hours. She's no idea that she's gone for 2 hours. It's just a different, it's like an African or Jamaican mentality. There's no like 3:15. You know, if you say, should we meet, you know, it's either soon or later. You know what I mean? There's no like precise times.
Right.
So it gets a bit of a challenge when you start getting deadlines and exact, you know, trying to sort out tours. And, yeah. So we're also lucky, and you know, obviously in the big gaps, we've always lost a lot of fans, I'd say, but particularly because of the way we've changed our sound as well. You know, I guess by the time we got to Lovers Rock, we'd kind of really moved away from anything that was, you could pass as smooth jazz, you know, could you say it's jazzy and all that. No, I mean, we hate the term smooth jazz for what we do, but, you know, all those kind of people, the smooth jazz people, I guess, kind of, I don't mean gave up on us, but didn't, you know, we were doing songs with strummy acoustic guitars and like By Your Side and stuff that was very different. So we probably lost audience, but then we gained, of all the people that we lost, we gained kind of the same amount with new people. Same with this, with the last album we had, Soldier of Love. You know, we gained a lot of new fans through young kids into hip hop who'd been told about Sade by Kanye or by Snoop Dogg, you know. I'm a soldier of love. Every day and night, I'm a soldier of love. All the days of my life, I've been torn up inside. Oh, I've been left behind. Oh, so I ride. I have the will to survive in the wild, wild west.
Soldier of Love hits in 2010 and reaches number one immediately, which is, you know, you talk about losing an audience. I, you know, like I kind of respectfully disagree. You know, it's amazing that you can, and that I think you even hold the record between.
No, we don't lose it. The amount, we don't lose the audience. We just kind of, we just change it.
It turns over.
You know, maybe we lose some of the older people and get some younger people.
Right. Yeah, Soldier of Love and Promise, I think, is the longest period between somebody having a number one album. I think you guys hold the record for that, which is like 23 years, which is incredible, you know, and, you know, just a testament to the work. So how did that, you know, sort of reconnection happen? Just kind of the same deal as Lovers Rock in terms of getting back together?
Yeah, I mean, when we did Soldier of Love. Yeah, that was the same kind of thing. We hadn't worked together for a while, but we just kind of got together. And we don't go in the studio for like a month at a time, but we'll get together just for a week or a couple of weeks to see what happens. And to be honest, most of the time, we're kind of showing each other YouTube clips or talking about other stuff, nothing to do with songwriting. You know, we just kind of mess around and come up with ideas. And it's so if people think that we take, you know, once we start recording, people think we maybe take a year to record the album. We're not in a studio for a year. We'll work for like 2 weeks, not do anything for a couple of months, then get back together. And it's not till the last month that we're kind of in the studio all the time, kind of finishing everything off and scrambling to finish a deadline. And what I think a big difference between us and other bands and artists is that we never really choose tracks for the album. We never kind of have like 15 songs recorded and decide which are the best ones to put on the album. If there's 9 songs on the album, one of which is an instrumental, that's because that's what we had at the end of the deadline.
Right.
Right. You know, like Love Deluxe, which is a perfect album for me, great length and everything, but there's only 9 songs on it, one of which is an instrumental. You know, other bands might have had like 12 songs or 13 songs to choose from. You know, we didn't. That's what we have.
Right.
When we hand the record in, there's never usually any leftover tracks.
Right. So you don't have like hundreds of hidden B sides and things like this.
No, unfortunately, no. That'd be kind of cool, but no.
Because there've been some greatest hits and repackagings and things like that. Obviously, Soldier of Love, you had a massive tour, and then you know you did the Lovers Live. Well, Bring It Home for that, and Lovers Live for the previous. Like those live DVDs CDs, you know, if I may, the often the power with within a band is in the performance. And those two specifically are just stellar by every measure.
I mean, we are. The thing about us live is that, we tend to, and I like this. Other people, other bands probably hate it. But we always do the songs exactly the same every night.
Right.
We very rarely change up the set. We'll change a couple of songs around here and there, but we don't, there's no sort of extended jam bits or different endings, or we do the songs pretty much like the record, but just maybe 10 or 20% more. You know, like the drummer hits everything a bit harder, the Charlie sings a bit like, everything's just a bit more dynamic.
Right.
You know, live. But, I don't know where I was going with that. I've forgotten the question.
Well, just about the power of a live performance.
Yeah, I mean, oh yeah. So, but the other thing is that we rehearse a lot, before we go on tour. We don't often run through the whole set as a whole thing, sort of till the night before we start. There's always some, figuring out the lighting or figuring out like the suits or whatever it is. But the band's pretty much tight, so there's you got the nerves of playing like the first gig, but everyone knows what they're doing,
Right.
And we everyone comes to the first rehearsal knowing what they should be doing. It's just kind of rehearsing them, getting tight.
And you guys have worked together for so long that, it's probably just a second language almost. That you know each other probably so well.
Yeah, I think so.
So. During these downtimes, do you hang out with the other guys? Like, do you see them?
We kind of spread around a bit. Like, Paul, bass player, is in he moves between LA and a place called Hastings in England. I don't see Paul a lot. We keep in contact. We email. If I go to LA, we hang out. Andrew, I see in London. He comes over to New York a bit.
Right.
I saw Sade a couple of months ago to visit her in England. We're not. We're just friends. It's like family, Like you don't have to talk to them all the time, but they're around.
Right.
You can just call up, and it's just the same. After nothing drastically changes. None of us have had super dramatic lives of in and out of jail or awful shit happening between the band. People getting fired or leaving. Do you know what I mean?
So it's, right.
It's just comfortable.
Right.
Yeah, we have our ups and downs, but it's just comfortable.
No. Yeah, an interesting thing about that I noticed on Soldier of Love is, all songs are credited to all, in terms of writing. Was that sort of a group team decision? Like, hey, let's just,
It's just kind of the way it was, I think. I'm not sure if we're all songs like that. I'm not sure. If we're working in the studio and everyone's putting something towards the song getting finished, then they'll get a credit. Yeah,
right.
It's like if a song is for me, the song, technically or kind of legally, I'm going from old school songwriting like Sinatra or Billie Holiday song. A song is a melody and the lyrics, right? And that melody and lyrics can be done with an acoustic guitar, it can be done with a big band, it can be done as a rock. Thing. It can be done as a reggae song, you can do it as a brass band, you can do a kids choir. It's like a song with lyrics and a melody. And the backing actually doesn't necessarily, that's not the actual song. That's the recording, that But it's how you get to that melody and lyrics. So if the drummer, like with, is doing some drum beat, that'll trigger Sade to think of some lyrics. Then he should for sure get a songwriting credit because he's helped the lyrics or the melody come along by him playing.
Right.
But if you have a song written and the drummer comes along and plays on it, that doesn't mean he gets a credit writing the song.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's how you got to the song. I think that's a confusion with drummers and bass players and people who are not normally credited for writing songs. They think, well, I play bass on it, I should get a writing credit.
Right.
If you were there in the inception of the song, and the reason that you played that bass line that ended up changing the song to being, the lyrics or melody, then yeah, of course. But if you're just kind of playing along, then no.
Right.
I think on the last album, we were definitely all putting our inputs in, for sure.
Right. Yeah. It reminded me of Queen at a certain point. I think it's on A Kind of Magic. They did all songs by Queen versus,
Right.
the previous songs would be written by Roger, written by Brian or Freddie or John, right?
Yeah,
But
yeah,
on that record, it was like a decision we're going to do all by Queen. So I was curious if that was
yeah.
a similar situation.
Then you always, then did you put, it's all about, it's like Lennon McCartney, when it always like, I think later on they did some reissues and it was McCartney and Lennon.
Right,
And
exactly.
they swapped it around.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Just one more song I wanted to ask about, which I think was recorded after Soldier of Love for one of the greatest hits packages, is Love Is Found. So would that kind of have been the last song you guys have written and recorded to date?
Yeah, I guess. Yeah.
Okay.
Is it that one? Well, I think she wrote a song with Tony Momo that was on. Which song did you just say?
Love Is Found.
Love Is Found. Yeah. That's probably the last one. Yeah,
Yeah,
yeah.
that's great.
And that was done when we were doing the, doing the best of or the ultimate collection, and we needed more tracks,
Right,
and
okay.
so we ended up doing that and a couple of other songs.
I know my eyes already like you, baby you. I know that love is found, love is found.
That's a personal favorite of mine.
Oh yeah, because I love playing that live. Yeah.
Oh, that's incredible. And the video and the sort of choreography and Sophie Muller, like the stage production of you guys' concerts was, it's just always incredible. Just so
Oh
visually
yeah. I mean,
compelling.
that's very Sade, Sade's influence, but also Sophie Muller,
Right.
who does our videos and for the last few tours just helps do the lighting and set design. And they're very unique because they went to college together. They've known each other since they were like 18, 17 or 18 or something. And they have a really cool relationship that, Sophie is the least sort of sycophantic sort of yes person. She's just like, if Charlie's got wearing something, an idea for something on stage, she goes, "Oh my God, what are you wearing? That's awful." She's like complete, and they're kind of like very, very honest with each other. Well, we all are, we can, you just say what you think, And so out of that, it's this very comfortable way of them working together, and Sophie knows what will work for Sade and what won't. They have a similar, I guess I call it like a naff meter. Naff just means, what's embarrassing or crass, I guess, a similar word to crass, but naff. So they, they, Sade hates certain colored lights or this kind of stuff. So Sophie knows how to work for Sade.
Right, gotcha.
So Sade's definitely a massive influence on the and all the staging. But we all do. We all throw in our ideas and stuff. And that's like ideas for the back screen and curtains and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah. Well, it's certainly the results are impressive and much appreciated.
Yeah, we just, I think we wanted every, to be, it was almost like a theater piece where there'd be different acts and different sort of, we got changed and then there's different sort of scenes and every song had a different look completely, It was very theatrical, I think.
Yep, definitely. So around about, I think 2013 is when you put together your new project. I don't want to call it a side project, but it's
Right.
Twin Danger. You want to
Twin
talk about
Danger, yeah.
how did that come to be?
Well, I'd met the girl, Vanessa Bley. I'd met her in New York like a couple of years earlier. We just kind of, just through mutual friends and working and stuff. She was working with this singer, this Estonian singer-songwriter she'd been writing a couple of songs, and then I was trying to work with this girl as well, separately. And then this girl, she's called Curly, she's from Estonia, and she said, oh, you know, I know this girl, Vanessa, you should meet her, you'd get on, you know, you both got similar tastes, and you both got a silly sense of humor. So I ended up meeting Vanessa, and I loved, she used to send me her demos, I just loved the music. She was very, very, very eclectic, like myself, in her musical taste. She loved Black Sabbath, and she loved classical music, and she loved film music and jazz, and,
right.
You know, Marvin Gaye, you know, she's all over the place. And she'd send me these demos, one which sounded like a bit of an opera, and another one that was very soulful, another one that was kind of more punky. I just loved what she was doing, and she had, she'd do like solo gigs on her own, just as Vanessa Blay. And I used to sometimes play guitar with her, kind of like this kind of rock thing. But we never really thought about writing together. And then I was in England, and I was messing around on the guitar and had these kind of quirky chords. And I thought, these, you know, I like these chords, but they couldn't really, they're not really right for a song particularly. But, and I was kind of talking to her on the phone or email or something. She said, oh, send me it. So I sent her like a really rough demo, and she immediately wrote a song back to it. And that was the song Just Because.
There's a charm, there's a mystery, a little sense of uncertainty. Just because I pretend and I really try, tell myself I'll still get by. Just because. Is it me with whom you like to be? Love will come and go, but it's here deep inside of me, moving real slow.
I was like, wow, she managed to do a melody and lyrics over this. And so I ended up like doing a demo of that with like a little jazz loop. It sounded like it should have brushes on it and a upright bass. So I did like a little demo. And then we did another song, kind of similar style. And then someone from a label heard it. Well, I played it for someone at a label because I was looking for other musicians. And he said, wow, I love this. If you finish this, finish an album, I'll sign you. And that was originally with Blue Note. So we did this whole, ended up just doing a whole record. And we kept to the style we were doing, those very sort of minimal kind of jazzy songs. You know? We did everything ourselves. It was just recorded onto a laptop in a really small room. And we kind of bring in musicians as we needed them, like live drums, bass, or a trumpet and stuff.
Right.
We did everything else ourselves. And we just kind of did this record, and we ended up signing to Blue Note. But then Blue Note got taken over by EMI, and we got kind of, you know, that whole thing where you end up sitting on the shelf for ages, nothing is happening. So, and we'd finished the Sade tour at that point, and I was raring to do something else, you know. And so we ended up getting off the label, and then, I don't know how long it was, like a year later, ended up signing to Decca. Someone at Decca heard it, Decca Classics, which is another, you know, classic jazz label, and we were like, perfect.
Right, perfect.
So we put it out. But I mean, the same thing, I mean, it's absolutely, you know, it's different, completely different than Charlie, obviously, but it's similar in the way that when we did the record together, me and Vanessa, we remotely didn't think about, you know, about radio or playing live or anything. We were just doing some music that we wanted to do for ourselves. And it was just later on, it was a challenge for, you know, for the label and radio, press and all that kind of thing to figure out what we are, you know, because everyone's a little scared of the jazz tag, you know.
Right.
Because people have sort of connotations, younger people have connotations of jazz, you know, they either think of it as like Kenny G, smooth jazz, or they think of it as, you know, a lot of guys kind of, you know.
Noodling, you know, right.
Showing off on stage. So,
right.
But what we weren't doing that, we wanted it to be more kind of old school, cool Chet Baker, you know, kind of vibe.
Right. Well, whatever, I mean, aside from the work, whatever the label's doing, at the time we record this, it's currently number 2 on Billboard's Contemporary Jazz and number 7 on the jazz chart. So
yeah, and the first week, it was number 1 on the iTunes jazz charts, which was like, what the hell? I think it slipped down pretty quickly. We nudged Lady Gaga and Nina Simone out the way for a minute. I think that maybe it was on pre-sales or something. But that was amazing, yeah. I mean, we love to... I mean, we are... You know, the record is jazzy, but it's jazz, but it's jazz because of the instrumentation and it's songs, you know, it's basically songs. So, you know, when I was trying to explain the analogy, when I was a kid and you go out to punk clubs or, you know, go all these rock gigs and punk gigs, but when you went home, you didn't want to put the pistols on or the Clash or whatever. You'd end up either putting some reggae on or you'd end up putting Tom Waits on. Or Leonard Cohen or something like that, you know what I mean?
Right.
So that's how I think we can fit in, you know, it's music for, it can be music for any age, but it's just not, you know, it's not your usual fare. I don't know, maybe it's a bit more late night, lights off, you know.
It's great. How did the, there's an interesting cover on this record too. It's the Queens of the Stone Age, No One Knows. How did that come about?
I think we were just wanting to do some new songs, like, live, you know, because we've been playing the same songs. We hadn't written anything. We were kind of busy doing stuff. We were like, oh, we should do... People always like, hey, do you any covers, you know? And we'd done a few kind of jump blues songs, but they're, you know, swingy kind of things.
Right.
And then we were just like, oh, we should do a cover. And I don't know, we've all got eclectic tastes, and it's just a song I've always loved. And I loved the dynamics of it and the lyrics. I just thought that'd be, you know, it could be a cool song for us to try, so we, you know, we tried a couple of different variations in the rehearsal room, and then Vanessa kind of arranged it a lot more, kind of made it a lot more dark and sexy, kind of stripping it down. Made it a lot more cooler, and then we just went in the studio and recorded it live. That was live recording.
It's real interesting. You probably could have pulled in Dave Grohl for that one to play drums, right?
Yeah.
I think he plays.
Exactly, yeah.
I think he plays on the original on that
one.
He plays.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So your Twin Danger is based in New York. Do you have any plans on taking that on the road, or?
I mean, we'd absolutely love to. We've been playing gigs, and people love us when we play live, and it's very odd because we get people dancing. People don't necessarily dance to the fast songs, they'll dance to the slow songs, you
right.
know what I mean? Like you get couples kind of making out and stuff. And we always try and, you know, Vanessa's very She's not the usual kind of jazz singer. She's a lot more confrontational, a lot more kind of confrontational live. So if people are standing away from the front, she'll just jump down there and make the stage bigger. And the band kind of play everything, same, like we do with Charlie, like 20-30% more live. We're doing the songs the same, but it's just maybe a bit more stripped down. The guitar player is a bit more distorted, and it's just a lot more dynamic.
Right.
And we look like a band live. Everyone in the band is more from the rock side of things and the jazz side of things. We've kind of definitely got a look together. We look like a gang on stage.
Right.
People seem to really like. So, yeah, we want to get on the road for sure.
And I'm assuming you would not do any Sade songs as part of Twin Danger, right? They're two separate.
No, we did actually don't tell Sade, but we actually did. Is it a crime? We played in Japan a couple of years ago. We got taken out to Japan, like, weirdly enough, and it was billed. It's meant to be this Twin Danger. We're like, how the hell are we going to sell any tickets? But we ended up getting it, and it was like Stuart Matthewman from Sade presents Twin Danger.
Right.
We found out about it, so we thought, oh shit, we better do something.
Right.
So we did a version of Is It a Crime, and actually Vanessa nailed it. She was really good. Obviously, it wasn't the same, but
right.
We got away. We winged it. We got away with it.
So, kind of wrapping up, just one kind of quick question. You mentioned a lot of your influences are, Sex Pistols and Sabbath, which brings Tony up. Like, do you ever just want to rock? Like, go crazy?
Huh?
Have you ever just
ever
wanted
want
to
rock?
Have you ever wanted to just, like, cut loose?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, I mean, I used to be when I was a kid, I was in, like, a punky band. I got to do it then. But it was Sade. You're doing certain songs, like, Northern Ain't Love. Live is very rocky.
Oh,
very
absolutely.
Rocky. We do a song, like, on the last tour, we did a song, Skin, which is quite a mid-tempo kind of R&B song. And towards the end, we break out into full-on kind of, rock mode.
Right.
So, I get to do it enough,
Right.
Maybe I wanted to a bit more when I was younger, but I'm okay. I'm okay doing what I'm doing. I mean, I'm loving doing Twin Danger now.
Yeah, it's really great. So as far as websites go, twindanger.com is the one, correct?
Yeah. And, on the usual stuff, the Facebook, everything's always up on Facebook. But, I have my own personal one, and there's Twin Danger one.
Right.
So you can always see what's going on there.
Right. Dare I ask if there's anything in the works or on the horizon, Sade-wise?
Yeah, I guess if the horizon, if you've got a big enough telescope, yeah. No, we're definitely going to do something at some point, for sure. Just when, I don't know. I mean, people always say, when are you going to do another Sade album? And I always say the same thing. I always say, how long is a piece of string?
Right.
It just depends on how long the string is, I mean, so it just depends. We will do something, and we'll definitely play live again. But it could be next year, it could be the year after, I don't know. I mean, we're not going to leave it 10 years, for sure.
Right. Well, we're already 5 years in from Shoulder of Love, so.
Yeah, all right. Yeah, we did a tour and an alternate thing.
Right.
We had some new songs. Give us a break.
I'm just busting your balls. I was going to say, at this pace, we should be like 2020 or something. I'm just kidding.
Yeah. I mean, we're all joking. As long as we don't need wheelchairs to get on stage, we'll be okay. I mean, you look at the Rolling Stones, they're still getting up there. So. See, whenever you see Sade, she always looks... It was more and more beautiful anyway, so
no doubt.
There's no worries there.
The one great thing about that is, like, I'm just sort of teasing you about the periods between, but
yeah,
if it was maybe more rapid fire, maybe the quality would diminish or something, like the audience is there and it kind of will always be there to follow their narrative at whatever pace works for you guys.
I think people always forget, when they come to the gigs, like, people come, younger people come for a couple of songs that they know, and then they, every song gets an enormous cheer because people realize, oh shit, yeah, I forgot about that one. Oh god, yeah, this one. Oh my god, this one. Whether
right.
it's a song that they listen to at college or with their girlfriend or their parents listen to or whatever, people don't realize how many sort of well-known songs Sade has. They always go, oh, Smooth Operator. And that's, oh, come on.
Right.
There's a lot out there.
Right. I have kind of a funny question for you, kind of a rhetorical one.
Yeah.
Do you have any sense of how many people have gotten laid because of your music?
No idea. I don't know. I mean, we probably fucked up people trying to get laid as well, because some of the, you put a record on, and some of it will be like a beautiful love song, and then the next song could be about a woman starving in Somalia,
That's true. That's a
and then
good point.
another song she's like completely broken hearted and saying that she'll. So they're very, very dark kind of lyrics. So on an album, you can get a bit of everything. I think if you just want to have Sade for love making, I think you have to do your own kind of playlist
Right.
mixtape.
You're, I think you guys are right up
I
there
mean, unless you
with
just don't
that.
listen to it, unless you don't listen to the lyrics, which is obviously
Right.
some people don't do.
Right. Yeah. All right. Well, Stuart, I can't thank you enough for all the years of music, and I'll be listening to it for the rest
Oh,
of my
well,
life
good. Thank you.
and enjoying it, and it's always incredible, and whenever the next record comes, I'll be first in line to buy it. So, so thank you for that, and
I'll send you one, don't worry.
nice. I will hold you to that. again, thank you for listening to this episode, and I hope you enjoyed the conversation as much as I enjoyed having it. Sade is one of those bands, like I said, that doesn't get a ton of press, and particularly the band. I guess everyone sort of gravitates to speak to her, but, you know, those guys in that band, is just they're just incredible. So thank you for listening. You can find more about Stuart's new project, Twin Danger, online, as he indicated, and Sade online as well. For Pods and Sods, you can find more episodes on iTunes. We're on Facebook, facebook.com/podsods. You can find us on Stitcher. You can find us on our blog, which is podsodcast.blogspot.com. And all the episodes are listed there, including, you know, something of interest if you listen to this would be our retrospective on the 80s. We kind of go year by year and go really in depth. So hopefully you'll check that out, and additional interviews and all kinds of nonsense. So I want to thank you for listening, and I'd like to close on some powerful words of wisdom from a hero of mine, Mr. Bill Hicks. Thank you.
The world is like a ride at an amusement park, and when you choose to go on it, you think it's real, because that's how powerful our minds are. And the ride goes up and down and round. It has thrills and chills, and it's very brightly colored, and it's very loud, and it's fun for a while. Some people have been on the ride for a long time, and they begin to question, is this real, or is this just a ride? And other people have remembered, and they come back to us, and they say, hey, don't worry, don't be afraid, ever, because this is just a ride, and we kill those people.
Shut him up.
We have a lot invested in this ride. Shut him up. Look at my furrows of worry. Look at my big bank account and my family. This has to be real. It's just a ride. But we always kill those good guys who try and tell us that. You ever notice that? And let the demons run amok? But it doesn't matter, because it's just a ride. And we can change it anytime we want. It's only a choice. No effort, no work, no job, no savings of money. A choice right now between fear and love. The eyes of fear want you to put bigger locks on your door, buy guns, close yourself off. The eyes of love instead see all of us as one. Here's what we can do to change the world right now to a better ride. Take all that money we spend on weapons and defense each year and instead spend it feeding, clothing, and educating the poor of the world, which it would many times over, not one human being excluded, and we can explore space together, both inner and outer, forever in peace.